Welcome to worship today as we gather this Lenten season. I was telling the kids in Sunday school a little bit about the colors we use in our worship space. Like we've got all this purple here, and sometimes it's green and sometimes it's white and different colors. And these colors are symbolic. And during this Lenten season, we think of how God sent his only son to die for us and to live for us. And so the color purple is a royal color, and it reminds us that it is from the kingdom of heaven that God has sent his son to us. Our opening hymn is one of these old Lenten hymns. It is number 338 in the hymnal. In the bulletin it says 339, but we sing Beneath the Cross of Jesus, hymn number 338. As we receive Holy Communion today, we sing hymn number 471. We come together to break the bread.
Let us break bread together. Let us praise God together on Let us praise God together.
Ushers, please wait on us as we share our offerings at this time. And I have a few announcements I'd like to share with you as well. Last night, a number of people gathered in the Church Fellowship Hall for an absolutely fantastic sweetheart dinner, we called it. And it was really wonderful that we could get together and young people going to the National Youth Gathering in Detroit this coming summer were serving that dinner. And I could not have imagined that the Church Fellowship Hall could be used for anything other than coffee and cookies, but it was really, and hot dish, but it was really a fantastic dinner, and these young people transformed the Fellowship Hall into a dining establishment. It was very cool. So we wish our young people well as they continue to make plans for that great trip to Detroit this summer. Our sympathy to the family of Kathleen Jones. Kathleen's two daughters actually are members here at Zion, and their kids are involved in Sunday school, and we had Kathleen's funeral this last week, and so please remember her family in your prayers as they move through these days. Wednesday evening, our Lenten dinner will be spaghetti this week, so if you really dig spaghetti, this would be a good time to come together. And then our worship service is at 7 o'clock. And confirmation will follow that. Church rummage sale coming up in March, so if you have a closet that you have not looked in a long time, or a Rubbermaid tub that is full of things that you have no idea what's in there, and you feel like sharing some of the unused wealth, our women's group puts this together, and it's a great, great thing, and it's good for our community as well. So with those announcements, we will receive our offerings. Thank you. And we continue as we pray. Oh God, by the passion of your blessed Son, you made an instrument of shameful death to be for us the means of life. Grant us so to glory in the cross of Christ, that we may gladly suffer shame and loss for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. One announcement, is Gloria here? I thought there was an announcement for the World Day of Prayer. That information is in the bulletin, but she had wanted to pass along that invitation that area churches get together every year about this time, and this year Peace Lutheran is hosting the World Day of Prayer, and it is this Friday at 1:30 in the afternoon, if anyone is able to be there. We hear the scripture readings at this time. From Genesis chapter 17. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you
and will greatly increase your numbers. Abram fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. God also said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her. And from the New Testament letter to the Romans, chapter 4, it was not through the law of Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who depend on the law are heirs, faith means nothing, and the promise is worthless, because the law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is our father in the sight of God in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls into being things that were not. Against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet, he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words, it was credited to him, were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. This is God's word. Thanks be to God. I'd like to invite our kids to come up, a few here, and we are going to take a little bit of a hike. Just a little bit of a hike. Yeah, come on up, but I don't want you to get off the side. You know what I'm saying? All right. Hey. How you doing? Good. Good to see you again. You know, your eyes just sparkle like the sun. God made a promise to Abraham. And God's promise was, I will be your God and you will be my people. Can you think of a time that God made a promise to you? God made a promise to you. Thoughts on that? Let's go this way. I want to give you a hint. Big, big hint. Okay. We're going to stand here. What are we doing here? Right here. This is where
people are baptized. You were baptized here not very long ago, right? And here are the words. These are God's words. You are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we say, amen. Because we really believe that. That God baptizes us, and in this gift of baptism, God says, now you are my child. God receives us as his children. And that's a promise. How long is that promise good? Forever. I think you're right. Yeah. Forever. So God makes a promise, and it is forever. We're going to come down this way. Want to come down? You fly. Come over here. Here's another place where God makes a promise to us. This is when we receive Holy Communion. You'd have to try one of the labels, wouldn't you?
Yes.
And this is a promise that God makes to us that we are forgiven. And so Jesus comes to us again and again and again. Jesus keeps coming to us, and sometimes we come to him, right? This is one of the ways that we can come to Jesus. And then when we receive his body and blood, we receive the bread and wine, we can take a moment and we pray. So let's take a moment right now as we pray. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us forever. That's something that we don't always understand, but we believe that your word is true. And so we return to you, Lord, with open hearts and open minds, that we can receive your word of life and new life, and help us to live that life even today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Ooh. You left and then you came back? I'm going to say you could be seated now. Okay. There you go.
So, here we are. Today we hear about Abraham and Sarah. And it's right at that point of their lives where God comes to them and gives them a new name. No longer Abram and Sarai. God says, I will give you a new name. And at that very moment, everything changed in their lives. And at that very moment, everything changed for you and me too. God made an eternal covenant with Abraham and all his offsprings and all his descendants to follow. And Romans chapter 4, we heard those words just moments ago too. Romans 4 expands on that a little bit, and it expands it beyond the time of Abraham and Sarah, across the centuries and across nationality borders and across religious borders and borders of race, to include another group of people. The first group of people who received that promise were the descendants of Abraham, the Hebrew people. The second group of people to receive that promise is a very, very different group. And this is a group not bound together by nationality, but bound together by faith. And so we are now included, you and me. All who believe are included in this ancient promise. So the original covenant, old covenant that God made with Abraham, was fulfilled when the new covenant with Jesus was made. Now, the word covenant is a super important word in the Bible, because another word for covenant is testament. You ever heard that one before? Old Testament, New Testament. This is the covenant that God made with the people. He made the covenant first with Abraham. He fulfilled that covenant when he made the new one with Jesus. So this testament, this covenant, is a binding agreement. Sometimes we use the word promise when we're talking about what God brought about here, but it's a little different. Covenant is different from promise in a very important way. A promise can be broken. A promise can be broken. It's no longer a promise anymore, but even sometimes with our very, very best intentions, we make a promise and it doesn't always hold. Something changes in us, something changes in the situation. But a covenant is a binding agreement, and it is an agreement. A covenant will never be broken. That's the main difference. And God makes this covenant with Abraham, and Abraham is somewhat overwhelmed by this whole thing because he knows he cannot keep up his end of the covenant. Abraham knows he will fail. We see that early on in this reading, that he fell on his face before God. I don't know exactly what was going on with Abraham at that time, but I think there was maybe some shame involved in it. It was not just being blown away by the presence of God, because he was already talking with God. It was when God told him to be blameless that Abraham crumbled, because he knew he couldn't do it. Maybe Abraham was feeling something of despair, not wanting to be a failure, but knowing that's exactly what would happen. I wonder, too, if maybe there was something of grief in what Abraham was feeling. He fell on his face before God because he knew that he could not honor God as deeply as he wanted to. He really wanted to honor God in the way he lived his life. But he had fallen short so many times, it's like, what am I going to do? God, talking to God face to face. And God says, you can be blameless. Abraham says, not a chance. Interesting to me that this covenant takes into account that one side of this agreement knew that it was not going to happen. God still made the covenant, an unbreakable covenant with this fallible creature. God honored the covenant anyway. We see this happening over and over and over again in the Bible, that God's people wander away from God. And God keeps calling them back home. And sometimes it's a long time, and sometimes it's a relatively short period of time. But God's people come back to God because they know there is no place else to go. We see that in the story of the prodigal son, where the son really dishonored his father and walked off, never really needing old dad again. But he knew that that's where he had to be. And he came back on his own terms, and the father, I believe God in this parable, welcomed him with open arms. He said, you are always my son. And that's the nature of this covenant, that God has promised to us in holy baptism, that we are God's children. That's a promise that God made. And I think that is an incredible image of the gospel, the good news. It's super good news that we always belong to God. So we are gathered today to celebrate the new covenant. The new covenant in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. This is a new thing in some ways, that through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we gather here for this Holy Communion. This is an image of the new covenant that will not be broken. That is the power of faith for us, even though we do not ever completely understand this. Last Sunday and this Sunday and next Sunday, I'm meeting with our fifth grade kids and their parents, and we're talking about Holy Communion. And there is something very mysterious about this. As we looked at this bread and wine, we said, does this look like God on the table to you? No. I don't think that's what God looks like. But somehow Jesus said that he is present in this Holy Communion. Through the bread and the wine, he says, this is my body. And I say, I don't get it. And he says, that doesn't change the fact. This is my body and this is my blood given and shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. That is the power of the covenant that God has made with us, even though we fall short. He comes to us again and again. So in this new covenant, it seems to me about the only thing I can bring to God is my own brokenness. That's about the best I can give him. That's what Abraham did. Abraham felt a certain inadequacy to hold up his end of the covenant. It was a kind of godlessness almost, although Abraham was not godless. He loved God. But there was something definitely that was a distance between Abraham and God, and it caused him to fall on his face and to plead helplessness. When Abraham told Sarah what God had told him, all Sarah could do was laugh. She laughed at Abraham. In fact, they named their first child Laughter. The irony of this is amazing. And Abraham did not get angry with his wife for laughing at his righteousness, because most wives know how righteous their husbands really are. It isn't really always that great, but here we are. And Sarah knew that Abraham was not the right guy for the job. But God knew Abraham. And God knew Sarah. And God loved Abraham and Sarah with his whole heart. And he says, you are my people, and you will always be mine. And so we come to God in our own brokenness, and God makes the same promise to us. I will always be there for you. Always. You are my people. God loved Abraham and Sarah. God loves you and me. We read in John 3:16, some of you got that one memorized, right? God so loved the world. Picture it. God so loved the entire world that he gave his only son. And all of us who come to him in faith, and even that fallible, sinful faith that we bring to the altar, God loves us all. We are a mess sometimes, God's beloved ones. Like Abraham, maybe we wish we could all do just a little bit better. But you know what? We are who we are. And God gets that better than we do. Abram fell on his face, and we do fall on our faces sometimes too. And in this covenant that God makes, he will always be there for us, always be our God, and we will always, for all eternity, be children of God. That's some kind of a covenant, isn't it? That's some kind of an arrangement that God made for you and me. Now, if we need to hear that again, I would encourage you to read Romans chapter 8. You can remember that, Romans chapter 8. Read that sometime. Actually, 6, 7, and 8 is a really awesome stretch of scripture, but you know, some people are a little bit nervous, like 3 chapters of the Bible in one day. I can do one. Today, read Romans 8. Because an amazing question is asked there that reminds us of the covenant God made with us. The question is, who shall separate us from the love of God? Who, what can possibly separate us from the love of God? Maybe you already know the answer, But it would be good to read it right from God's word. It says there that nothing in all creation, neither height nor depth nor angels nor principalities, it goes on, nothing at all ever will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. Romans 8:39. If one chapter is too much, one verse is awesome. Romans 8:39. Nothing will separate us from God's eternal love. So God tells us that he will hear us. And God tells us that he will carry us. And God tells us that he will save us and forgive us and love us. That is his end of the covenant. And it is permanent and it is good. And God knew the whole time that we would fail from time to time. And when we want to give honor to God, there are times that we just, it doesn't go so well for us, but it goes very well for God because he still loves us. God knew that we would fail from time to time, but he says he will still be our God and we will still be his children. That is the true nature of this covenant. That is the power of this gift of Holy Communion that we receive today. And as we gather in this time and in this place, I hope you realize that Holy Communion is not just some ritual that churchy people do to show that we're religious, right? This is not our act. This is God's gift to us. This is God's new covenant for us. And God does everything that he said he would do, and we have salvation in Jesus Christ. Humbly, we bow our hearts in deepest gratitude for this eternal gift of salvation. We could not save ourselves. Another great Bible verse kind of really gives me hope. Is Matthew 19:26. We are told that with God all things are possible. For us, not so much, but God knows what to do. And we are now made new into the image of Christ. I could not have seen that happening. That I could be the image of Christ. You are the image of Christ. All things are possible with God. This gift of Holy Communion is a free gift too. It's a free gift of God's grace. We are forgiven. We are promised new life. May we receive that new life today and see God's tremendous love no matter what. We belong to God. Let us thank God for the covenant of his eternal love, and in all things, may we strive to live for him. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And as we receive Holy Communion today, we confess those sins that we bring to God, and we receive his forgiveness. Our confession is, the service of confession is on page 94. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sins, whose mercy endures forever. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us, even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. As we receive Holy Communion, our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. He broke it, he gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Holy Communion is prepared. And if, as you come forward, we receive the bread and the wine. If you abstain from alcohol, the center ring of each tray is for you. If you prefer a gluten-free wafer, they're on the table. If you pick your own wafer up then and bring it forward as we receive this gift.
This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come into this time and place, we step into your presence. We trust that you are always with us, but here we gather with our brothers and sisters in the faith. May we find strength in your presence, but also as we come together, may we be here for one another. Help us to love one another the way you love us. Help us to forgive one another the way you forgive us. And as we receive this promise of the covenant today, help us to believe that you will never leave or fail or forsake us. And even if we fall far from you, you are still our God, and we are still your people. We thank you for your word, and we ask that you would help that word to take root in our own hearts, and that we would be hungry for your word, and that we would find that all you say will satisfy us and lead us. We take a moment for our own silent prayers at this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please rise as we receive the blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We go in peace now to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our final hymn reminds us that we are servants of God. Hymn number 825.
With angels above and thanks never.